Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. In order to get in as many questions as possible, I'd appreciate succinct questions and answers. And question number one is Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding the United Kingdom Internal Market Act 2020.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Internal Market Act represents an unprecedented assault on the powers and the responsibilities of the Scottish Government and of the Scottish Parliament. It was introduced despite an explicit refusal of consent by this Parliament and also by the Welsh Senedd. And my ministerial colleagues regularly make clear to the UK Government our continued opposition to the Act and our concern about the many ways it's being used by UK ministers to constrain and undermine decisions made by Scottish ministers and by the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I should have reminded members that if they do want to ask a supplementary question, that you should press R in the chat function, the request to speak button. And Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. The Internal Market Act was passed by Westminster in the full knowledge, as has been stated, that it conferred the right to alter the powers of this Scottish Parliament without our permission. Whilst UK ministers may give some limited commitment to allow for policy divergence, the Act fundamentally changes the relationship with all devolved institutions. Is this proof that power devolved is power retained? And can the Cabinet Secretary advise what options the Scottish Government has at its disposal to preserve the integrity of this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank my friend for that follow-up question. People in Scotland, of course, voted overwhelmingly to set up the Scottish Parliament after years of Westminster governments ignoring their wishes and imposing unwelcome, damaging policies. Devolution has improved people's lives in Scotland and delivered governments that they have chosen. This Parliament has introduced free personal care, it's abolished university tuition fees, and no one is now charged for prescriptions. The UK Government is now taking control, once again, of key devolved powers without the consent from Scotland. It's using Brexit as an excuse to rewrite and undermine the devolution settlement. The Internal Market Act allows it to take money from this Parliament and to spend it according to the choices of UK ministers, not elected in this country, not the priorities of democratically decided in Scotland, rather than by UK government ministers. The Act will also undermine future laws passed in the Scottish Parliament in areas like food standards, animal welfare and environmental protection. And this isn't just happening in Scotland.
Thank you. Question number two, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the expansion of the Global Scot network.
Minister Ivan McKee.
The programme for Government 2021-22 committed to growing the Global Scot network to 1,500 members by 2023. And as of the 23rd September 2021, there were 1,009 Global Scots. This has grown from 665 members when A Trading Nation was published in 2019. The network recently celebrated its 20th anniversary and has been acknowledged by the World Bank as an exemplar in how a diaspora can support economic growth. Consisting of entrepreneurs, business leaders, community figureheads, Global Scots are a vital component of Scotland's international network, providing Scottish companies with critical market insights. And the new Global Scot digital platform, launched in July 2020, allows members and companies to connect with each other more easily. And Global Scots are involved in regional advisory groups, furthering export and investment opportunities for Scotland across a range of countries globally.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Minister for that response. In 2019, the SNP announced plans to expand the Global Scot network from 600 to 2,000 members by 2021. As we've just heard, these targets are nowhere near to being met, with just over 1,000 members. Now, I fully appreciate that the COVID pandemic would have made it more difficult to expand the network, but does the Minister share my disappointment that this vital network is not reaching its full potential?
Minister.
I would go and check those targets. I don't think it was to grow up by 2021. A Trading Nation is a plan for a 10-year effort to grow Scotland's export activity. The member, if he's engaged with Global Scots, will understand the huge value that they bring to Scotland's networks. He'll understand the value that businesses get from that. And he'll understand also that the requirement to make sure that Global Scots that come onto the network are of sufficient standard and ranking within their business and their business communities to be able to contribute fully under their own steam to Scotland's export and investment potentials. And what I would say to the member is, if he's aware, and I know he's worked internationally in certain countries, if he's aware of anyone who he thinks would make a good Global Scot, I would really welcome his input on that. And if he can send me their names to my office, we will exactly follow up on that to get to these ambitious targets we've set over the longer term.
Supplementary, Eleanor Whittam.
The expansion of the Global Scot network is actually a testament to Scotland's appeal and ambition on the world stage. In light of this, how will the Scottish Government fully capitalise on its plans to establish two new offices in Copenhagen and Warsaw, further expanding its existing network of European and international hubs?
Minister.
Thank you for the question. Our international presence creates domestic opportunities, broadens our horizons and ultimately benefits the people of Scotland. And as the member indicates, we'll be establishing two new Scottish Government offices in Copenhagen and Warsaw. Those will sit alongside the existing SDI presence in those countries and alongside the existing Global Scot networks in those countries. And in the case of Poland, our trade envoy who has been in place there for the last 3 years. So it's a real opportunity for us to continue to expand Scotland's export and investment ambitions, and those investment hubs will be very much part, an integral part of Scotland's global footprint overseas and the work that we're doing with our Global Scots and others.
Question number three, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on Afghan refugee relocation resettlement with reference to the different elements of the new Scots strategy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank my colleague for her question. The Scottish Government is committed to playing our part in welcoming and supporting people fleeing Afghanistan. We continue to urge the UK Government to increase the number of refugees it will accept and to provide more information and confirmation of a start date for the Afghan Citizens Resettlement Scheme. As of the 26th of September, around 230 people and 61 families have arrived in Scotland across 9 local authority areas under the relocation scheme for locally employed staff. In line with the key principle of the new Scots refugee integration strategy, local authorities are working to support their integration from day one of their arrival in Scotland. Partnership and collaboration are central to the new Scots approach, and the Scottish Government is working with the Home Office, with the Convention of Scottish local authorities and third sector and community organisations to provide people with the safety and security that they need to rebuild their lives.
Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? We know that one key way to support asylum seekers and refugees to settle and become part of their new country is to give them access to work. And we know, as we've already heard in this chamber today, that we need workers in Scotland. Many sectors are under immense staffing pressure. Many of us will have been contacted by employers who want to consider refugees for employment in sectors that are crying out for more staff. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what support we can make available to people resettled via the Afghan Relocation and Assistance Policy to find employment? What we can do to provide support for employers, such as care homes in my region, who want to support refugees into employment? And does he agree that people seeking asylum should also be given the right to work alongside refugees, unlike the UK Government, who, despite a promise made by the Prime Minister in 2019...
Short questions and answers, please. Cabinet Secretary.
To review that policy, has refused to do so.
Briefly, I agree entirely with the sensible points that my colleague has made. The new Scots strategy recognises that integration is a long-term and multifaceted process. We work to ensure that people can access the support and services that they need as they settle in Scotland, including those related to health, education, language, employability and welfare rights. I'll raise the specific questions about employment, training and employees who would wish to employ Afghans as a priority.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Two brief supplementaries. Firstly, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his elaboration on the new Scots integration strategy. With 2.6 million Afghan refugees and 3.5 million Afghan refugees internally displaced, would the Cabinet Secretary reiterate with myself and the First Minister that the UK Government's aim to resettle a total of 20,000 Afghan refugees including 5,000 the first year, is entirely insufficient?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I will. While the announcement of a UK-Afghanistan resettlement scheme is welcome in principle, the commitment to 20,000 in the long term and just 5,000 in the first year is inadequate. We believe a substantial increase in numbers being committed to is required if the UK government is to meet its responsibilities, and it's right that the new Afghan resettlement scheme will be in addition to the UK's existing global refugee resettlement commitment.
Thank you. And Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary well knows that hundreds of thousands of Afghans are fleeing from persecution and over two decades of war. Scotland must play its part in helping to resettle them. Can I ask the Scottish Government, what provision has it made to ensure councils have the funding to provide the new infrastructure to help to resettle the refugees, make the most of their new lives here?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, thank you very much. And can I commend the tone and constructive suggestions from the Labour Party on this question? He will know that the funding package is a matter for the Home Office, and we have been pressing the Home Office and the UK government to ensure that the funding package is fully in place. That is what we are working in collaboration with the Convention of Local Authorities in general and with specific local authorities who are making moves to try and accept the Afghan refugees. I'm happy to work on his behalf and his party's behalf in pressing on the UK government to deliver on their commitments, and I would urge him to amplify the calls that he's made in the chamber today.
Thank you. Question number four, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to cultural organisations in Mid-Scotland and Fife.
Minister Jenny Goldruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government provides a range of support to cultural organisations in the Mid-Scotland and Fife region, particularly in light of the pandemic. For example, organisations in Fife and Perth and Kinross have received over £3 million through our Performing Arts Venues Relief Fund and over £770,000 through our Cultural Organisations and Venues Recovery Fund. Full details of these funds are published by Creative Scotland. This funding has, of course, been vital in supporting cultural organisations and businesses throughout the pandemic.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for her response? According to a recent report, the number of people using the 8 open libraries in Perth and Kinross has fallen by 2/3 over the most recent period, perhaps not surprising due to the issues with COVID. Can the Minister tell us what more the Scottish Government might do to help encourage people back to use libraries to support this important local resource and make it clear that they're safe? And can she reassure us that Perth and Kinross Council, and indeed other councils in the area, will not see any reduction in funding due to a fall in the number of people using local libraries?
Minister.
I thank Murdo Fraser for that question. In response to his question specifically targeted on libraries, the member will be aware that the government takes this matter very seriously and recently introduced a libraries recovery fund to the tune of £1.25 million, which is being managed by the Scottish Libraries Information Commissioner, and SLIC will manage that fund. And one of the requirements with that fund is that it reaches those who need it most and that we get a geographical spread, which would of course include the member's region. Specifically on the member's question around about Perth and Kinross Council, I think local authorities have got a real key role to play here in terms of cultural provision, and I will be meeting with the culture conveners very soon. I hope and I am sure that Perth and Kinross will be part of those conversations as we move forward, because we absolutely need our local authorities to be part of that cultural recovery.
Thank you. Question number 5 has not been lodged. Question 6, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what role the Scotland on Tour Fund will play in aiding the recovery of Scotland's art sector.
Minister Jenny Goldruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The pandemic has had a significant personal and professional impact on those working in the live music sector. And we know that the sector will continue to face challenges even now that most parts of it can fully reopen. Musicians, bands, artists and venues will be able to apply to the Scotland on Tour Fund, backed by £750,000 from the Scottish Government, to bring new and additional concerts to venues and festivals in Scotland this year. Scotland on Tour will enable artists to reach new audiences and communities, widening opportunities to perform throughout the country.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Minister for her answer. The Scottish Government's commitment to this touring fund within the first 100 days of the current administration is timely and extremely welcome. In the opinion of the Scottish Government, to what extent will the Scotland on Tour Fund benefit all of Scotland's communities, including the Highlands and Islands, and not only urban centres?
Minister.
One of the key aims of the Scotland on Tour Fund is to create new performance opportunities throughout the country, including the Highlands and Islands where the member represents. And the organisation Active Events, who are tasked with delivering the Scotland on Tour project, are supported by a steering group which includes representation from the industry, such as the Scottish Music Industry Association, the Touring Network, Creative Scotland, the Edinburgh Fringe Society and the enterprise agencies, which includes Highlands and Islands. I hope this reassures the member that the voices of those within her region are being reflected in the direct development of the fund's eligibility criteria. We are committed to helping communities throughout Scotland have greater access to cultural activities, including live music, and Scotland on Tour will help support this ambition.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Sarah Boyer.
Thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I wonder if the Minister would support the initiative by Alison McGovern MP, who's currently going to Europe to ask for support in terms of visas for the touring industry so that they can tour not just in Scotland but the rest of Europe as well.
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. I'm not cited on the specifics of that programme, but if she would be able to share that with me, it would sound like something we in the Scottish Government would be keen to support. She may be aware that the Cabinet Secretary and I have made repeated representations to the UK Government on this issue. It is a real challenge for the sector just now. I met with the previous Culture Minister, I think in June, prior to the summer recess, when it was at the time Caroline Dynage, and made that point to her directly. So happy to work with the member on that, and it sounds as though we share the same interest in this space.
Thank you. Question number 7, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has met or has any plans to meet the recently appointed Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster to discuss constitutional issues in relation to Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Scottish Government is committed to constructive engagement with the UK Government on the basis of a partnership of equals, and is making clear to UK ministers, including the Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster, that following the Scottish election, it has an unarguable democratic mandate to offer the people of Scotland a choice about their constitutional future. I met and shared a platform with the outgoing Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster at the recent British-Irish Association meeting in Oxford, and I hope to meet his successor soon.
Jim Fairley.
Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that in light of the Times article last week or during this week, that we should encourage the Tories, despite instruction from their leadership, to continue to talk about the union and help the case for independence even further?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that's an entirely positive suggestion. I look forward to hearing those arguments from the Tory benches. In reading the article that my friend has highlighted, I think the reasoning was because they shouldn't sound too needy, was the advice that they were being given. Perhaps in striking a more consensual note, however, Presiding Officer, in seeking consensus, hopefully, as Democrats, we can all agree that in the recent Scottish Parliament elections, that the parties that stood on a manifesto commitment that the people should have a say on their future in a referendum won, and the parties that opposed a referendum lost. So as Democrats, hopefully, we can all agree that that was the outcome of the election, that is the mandate, and that is indeed what will happen.
Question number 8, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the development of a national centre for music.
Minister Jenny Goldruth.
The Royal High School Preservation Trust has put forward proposals to the City of Edinburgh Council for the restoration of the former Royal High School building as a world-class centre for music education and public performance for the benefit of the whole of Scotland. It would not be appropriate for Scottish ministers to intervene in advance of any decisions being taken by the City of Edinburgh Council as the current owners and the planning authority. However, as the member may know, I was employed at the Royal High School, although not in the old building, but I am watching developments with interest, particularly given the historic role of the school in terms of Scotland's proud history of education.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer? Given the site of the proposal, National Centre for Music, as she said, is within my region, can I ask the Minister what funding, if any, is available to Edinburgh City Council and councillors across Scotland if they want this scheme to go ahead, and how else can they encourage for this building to be brought back into public use?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. I don't want to prejudge the outcome of what the City of Edinburgh Council will say on this matter. So if the member will understand, I'm not able to give specific comment on funding at this moment in time, as no approach has been made from the council. But I am aware of a letter from William Gray Muir, who's the chairman of the Royal High School Preservation Trust, to the First Minister, and I would be happy to meet with him once the outcome of the council's consideration is known. As the member may be aware, the Scottish Government is supportive of St Mary's Music School already and has provided a budget of up to £1.6 million £1,000 a year to support up to 55 pupils from all over Scotland. I'm aware that the proposals as drafted would include the potential to relocate St Mary's, and I'm also aware that St Mary's School have already met with education officials on the matter. I understand the closing date, as previously mentioned, for applications for the future use of the Royal High School's old building was the 3rd of September, and as a member, as I've said, will understand it will be for the Council to decide when to announce the outcome of those applications. But I do look forward to meeting with the Chairman of the High School Preservation Trust after that time, and I'm also happy to meet with Mr Balfour on this matter if he would like to do so.
And we've got a supplementary from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Minister has said, the National Centre of Music's plans are an exciting example of Scotland's celebration and appreciation of culture, and it's really encouraging to know that the Scottish Government recognises the importance of culture centres in local communities. So would the Minister reiterate that the £1.25 million into Public Libraries COVID Recovery Fund is another brilliant example of this appreciation in action in communities across Scotland?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. Yes, I would agree, and I have referenced the Library Recovery Fund in response to Mr Fraser previously, but the government does recognise the valuable role that libraries play in their communities and how popular they are. In 2019, there were 40 million visits to public libraries in Scotland, more than to the Premier League and to cinemas combined. But this fund that I spoke to previously will help more services to be restored in libraries, including reopening. And it will also help libraries to continue to be at the heart of their communities and support their communities in terms of recovering from the pandemic.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes this item, portfolio questions. I'll point of order, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, earlier today, my colleague Douglas Ross asked the First Minister about the specifics of a certain section of a vaccine certificate scheme who is still being consulted on. The response was as follows. I don't have the regulations in front of me right now. I'm very happy to come back afterwards and go through every particular regulation and who precisely we have consulted. Deputy Presiding Officer, the First Minister made that offer. As far as I'm aware, she's not coming back to the Chamber this afternoon to answer those questions. Can you please help me as a humble backbencher? How do I persuade the First Minister to come back and ask the questions that I have and other members have about this completely flawed scheme?
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I think, as you will understand, the scheduling of business is a matter for the Bureau, and I would certainly encourage Mr Balfour's business manager to raise that with the Bureau at its next meeting. As I say, it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a statement from the Cabinet Secretary, Humza Yousaf, on the autumn and winter vaccine programme. I will allow a little bit of time for the front benches to change.